Greetings. Hello, everybody. Greetings. Yes, that girl peeking on the other side there is Hannah.
Hello.
How you doing, everybody?
Hi.
We're going to be talking about the arbaito, or part-time jobs in Japan, kind of exploring what you need to know if you do want to work here in Japan. A lot of it's pretty straightforward, but there are some things that you need to know, and Hannah here has some experience, and so do I. I've been working and living in Japan for 21 years. I've never done a baito. Arbaito comes from the word Arbeit.
Arbeit, yeah.
Arbeit, which German. Is German. And I'm not sure how this came here to Japan.
Yeah.
But it's a word that's known here for part-time jobs. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people are looking for this. It's one of the biggest questions that I get from viewers. So we're gonna discuss this. We also did this last year a little bit. Now you, Hannah.
Yeah.
Enough about my talking. How about you? You worked in a baito last year.
Yes, I did.
Tell us about that.
Yeah, last summer, I worked at a convenience store, actually, for about 4 months. And at first, when I applied, I guess, I brought my, you know, resume. They were very, they were hesitant to hire me because it's such a short period of time. 4 months is apparently short for a part-time job. But it's crazy how desperate a lot of places are right now for workers, because there are a lot of, it's an aging society, not enough young people working, and so they're very excited to bring me in, and it was honestly life-changing, because it taught me so many lessons just about the time management was one. You have so many tasks when you, you might not think this when you go to a convenience store, but the workers do so many things, you know, behind the scenes. And it's not just the cashier, it's putting products in the shelves and making sure that the products, the food life hasn't, is it called food life?
Yeah, the expiration date expiration on the food life.
Expiration date, yeah. Is not, you know, passed. You know, cooking the frying the chicken in the back, and
right.
There's so many tasks, and so it's really about organization, and it's about collaborating with your other partner. It's usually about minimum two people working on the shift at the same time.
Wow.
And so it's about dividing the work as well.
So the other staff.
The other staff, yeah.
Now, a little bit of background on Hannah. She was 20 last year.
Yeah.
So you were still a university student.
Yeah.
And you were just here for the summer.
Yes.
Then you had to go back to Montreal to university.
Yes.
So that's the basis of her part-time experience. She only had a fixed amount of time. But right now there's a crunch for the employment, because there's just not enough young people to work in the jobs, especially with the Olympics coming. There's going to be even a higher demand for baito, people working part-time to fill in the need, especially in Tokyo, for international visitors.
Exactly, who speak English,
right.
And can talk to the international visitors.
Yeah.
That was one thing, a strong point that I had in my hiring process, was that I could speak English.
Did they ask you that?
They did. They were like, do you speak English? And that's a plus, because there are a lot of tourists that come to the area I live in, which is Kamakura, which is an ancient city in Japan, very old Buddha statues. Anyways, there are a lot of tourists there, and so they have an issue with communicating with them. Although gestures, you can... But there's a limit to gestures, gestures can do. So they're very happy to have an additional English speaker in the group. So that's definitely a plus.
So, I can see this being a benefit, speaking English. But let me ask you, let me follow up on this too, because a lot of the people watching, of course, you speak English. The show is made in English.
Yeah.
How did, in practical purposes, while you were on the job,
yeah.
How often did your ability to speak English really was needed?
Right. I would say at least, I would say once a day.
Really?
Once a day, yeah. And my shifts were like 3 to 5 hours long. And in that time span, at least one, you know, English speaker would come in and they would ask for, there was one guy who came in asking if I could wash the fruit that he was buying.
it's prepackaged. Yeah.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. So he wanted to eat it, you know, as he was walking, I guess. And so he wanted me to wash that. And they have questions about, like, what kind of drinks there are at the convenience store. The ones that you make in the back, like by the coffee section.
Yeah.
So they're asking, what is this one? What is this one? What's the difference between these? So there are, yeah, at least once a day, I would say.
Okay.
Yeah, and I think that would probably most likely increase as, you know, like the Olympics get closer, I would think.
Did you teach English to your co-workers? I just said, because they probably were Japanese, right?
Yeah, they were
all
Japanese.
They didn't speak any English.
Yeah,
very little.
I would try, and they would be very open to learning.
Yeah.
They really, really, really want to learn, but they're afraid of making mistakes. I think this is a common trait among Japanese people, but they're always afraid of making mistakes and, you know, troubling the other person.
Oh.
And so there was a constant struggle of them not speaking, not trying to speak. But I would teach them a couple words here and there. And yeah, they also know that it's a necessary thing that they should improve on. Yeah.
So I just want to talk a little bit about it. Behind me is the Kua Hawaiian Burger chain. We have found a place, nice place to sit down in Tokyo. In the Shinmaru building in the Marunouchi side of Tokyo Station. It's a nice place. I want to give you some background now on what you need to get a job in Japan in general, all right? So I think I got about a dozen questions a day from people, and I just don't even respond anymore because you can Google this stuff too. Let me break it down for you. If you're living abroad and you want to work here in Japan, you need a visa. You can't just come here and magically get a job if you're on a tourist visa. It doesn't work like that. It may work in Thailand like that. You can skirt around the law. After Nova failed the English school back in like 2008 or something, the police have been very checky with visas and passports and things like this. And employers are hesitant to hire you if you do not have the visa. You have to have the proper documentation. That all starts in your country of origin. You need to get what's called a COE form, or Certificate of Eligibility. You take that form from the employer to the Japanese embassy, and they will issue you the work visa, and it takes a little bit it takes some time to do that. So that has to come from an employer in Japan. You have to set this up. Now, it does pay to come to Japan and search for the job, but realize that you're going to have to leave the country in order to get that work visa. You just can't get that in Japan, not that I'm aware of. The second thing is that if you don't want a baito and you want to get a well-paid job or a job in your industry, you're going to have to learn Japanese. Because there's right now thousands of people that are married to Japanese that have the work permits already that can't speak any Japanese looking for the same type of job. They have the work permit. It's easier to hire them than you. So you need to have a skill that they want. You also have to have the ability to sell your skill to them. Why should they hire you? This is about any job, anywhere. Doesn't even matter if you want to work in Japan. If you do not have the skill to sell yourself, then why should any company hire you just because you have a degree? That's not how it works anymore. It's very competitive, especially in Japan. So you need to speak Japanese, a minimum of at least Japanese language proficiency test level 3. I never took the test. I don't work for a Japanese company. I'm fine. I have had work credentials for 21 years, and once you get it, this is very important, it's very easy to extend it. We say visa renewal. It's not a visa renewal. It's a visa extension. And it's very easy to extend it. All you have to do is prove that you have the correct amount of income, that you make enough income, and you have proof of that income. But getting the first initial work visa is very hard. Extending in the same industry is actually a lot easier, right? So you need to have Japanese language abilities, you need a certificate of eligibility, a COE form, and you need to be hired by somebody initially. Or you can be a business investor, that's the fourth visa. and the fourth visa requires cash. And as we say, money talks in Japan. But it's a significant amount of investment, and I think you had to hire two workers, which could be, you know, old ladies or it could be young students or whatever it was, but you need to have an office and hire people, and then it was hard to maintain that visa, all right? So it was easier to get a job through a company and extend that than it was to get a business investor's visa, because it's hard to extend that. The problem, and this is the last thing I'm gonna say about this before we move back to Hana, the problem with, the most important thing that you should realize is that industry that you come in through your visa, that's what you're gonna be extending through the period of it. If you come in on a humanities visa, which is when an English teacher comes in, a specialist in international services, all right, you have to extend that. When you change industries, this becomes a problem. So if you want to become an engineer after you are an English teacher, you're changing your industry. Maybe that's not the best example, let me think. A scientist or a talent or something. To change your industry is very hard, but you can extend pretty easily within that industry. So these are some of the things that I've learned from my 21 years of living in Japan that might help you. But yeah, getting a job in Japan is the same as getting a job anywhere. It's up to you to market yourself to find that job. And Hana is pretty good at marketing herself. Because you speak, I know, I'm serious. You speak because you understand Japanese culture because you grew up here.
Yep.
You understand, you could speak English.
Yep.
You grew up in a bilingual, multicultural household. So you know about Japan and the West. So
yep.
That's a really valuable thing. We have a lot of people that are, we call them hafu.
Yeah, hafu.
Right? I'm hafu too, just not Japanese hafu.
Yeah.
But there's value in that. So it's easy for hafu to get jobs because they have a value to Japan. My value to Japan is that I've lived here for 20 years now and can bridge Japanese culture to the West using my talent in editing and telling stories and it's something I've built up for 20 years. It's actually my value to Japan and how I can continue to live here.
Yeah.
And my wife is Japanese, so
yeah,
I always have that.
There you go.
I got family.
Yeah.
But if you want to get a job here, you need to have something that Japan needs.
Right.
The skills that they need right now, do you know?
The skills. English speaking, definitely, I think, is one.
That is
right?
One, but not just anybody.
Right.
Right?
Right.
Because now Japanese younger people can speak English. It's improving a lot.
Mm.
More people are studying abroad. It's getting better.
Mm.
And they're learning English younger. So
right.
The skills that they need are nursing.
Mm-hmm.
So if you get a nursing degree and experience and you can speak a little bit of Japanese, you're probably going to get hired so easily in the profession here. Because we've got more old people in Japan than anywhere else in the world.
True.
And very few, because the population is decreasing.
Yeah.
Doctors, engineers,
mm-hmm.
they're looking for a lot of tech people. So you see a lot of people from India and South Asia coming here because of collaborations between the two governments.
Mm.
A lot of people on the subways now in Tokyo, you can see from India that are here for tech jobs. That can, and they've learned Japan before they came to Japan in programs. So they have a basic level of Japanese, it gets better as they get here. So you can't just, you can't just do what I did, which is get an English teacher degree and just stay, an English teacher's job and just stay here permanently. The system's getting harder and harder.
Mm.
It's getting harder and harder. Mm. So now that you did a Baito last year and you came back this summer and now you're helping me.
Yes.
Because I get support through Patreon. Thank you so much to our Patreon supporters. I can grow the Only in Japan brand, and actually your wages are coming from Patreon. Thank you, Patreon.
Well, thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Which
much.
Is really, really important. But I mean, what do you look for now in a Baito? The convenience store experience.
Yeah.
You shared that you learned so much from that.
Yeah.
Teamwork. A convenience store job in Japan is a lot more than what you think it is.
Yeah.
You're doing multiple tasks, like a waiter. You're learning steps.
Yeah.
You're learning responsibility at a young age on another level and getting paid poorly for it. What is the salary that convenience store workers get? And what do you see as the next Baito after convenience store jobs? What are some other jobs that interested you that you could have done?
Interesting. The wage for convenience store workers is about 980 yen an hour, which is around $10 an hour.
$9 or $10 an hour.
And it's higher in the early mornings, and it's higher at the midnight workers who go from all the way from 10 p.m. to like 7 a.m. in the morning. They get paid a little bit higher. What was your other question?
So you last year you worked as a convenience store worker. What other biker jobs had you considered?
Right. I considered working at a restaurant or a food serving job position because convenience store is a lot of things, but it doesn't consist of making food or making actual drinks or, you know, moving around the restaurant and serving the customers. And so I thought that would be a different experience. So I was definitely considering that, but the hours weren't what I wanted. And so I didn't apply for the job at the end. But that's definitely another experience in terms of time management and skills too, to have to create a certain drink and remember the recipe of a certain food between the time the customer pays for the food and then is on the other side of the counter waiting for it to come out. So yeah, I think that would be the next level of difficulty as well.
Yeah.
Different difficulty, not to say that one is more difficult than the other, but just a different level.
And cafe and like restaurant staff don't get tips, right?
There's no tip they system don't. Here. No, they do not.
So you would make less. Or well, on your base would be a lot more.
Right.
I think I made like $3 an hour when I was $3.25 an hour when I worked in Columbus, Ohio for wait staff.
Whoa.
That was really low. But with tips?
With tips.
Oh my word. I was
how
making
much
like
will you get?
It depends on how long the customer would sit there and how good my service was.
Oh my gosh.
I made anywhere between like $100, $150 a night to a lunch shift. I could just make $50.
Really?
Right, for 5 or 6 hours. You didn't really, the lunch shift, you had to do it every now and then, but it balanced out. You still, the restaurant's got to make cover the shifts, but.
Yeah.
Dinners were always like, if you had 4 or 5 tables and you knew your steps and could give the service to 4 or 5 tables,
yeah,
and you could hold a French tray,
man,
you could make a lot of money, and especially if the turnover was higher. The faster you get the food to them, the faster the services, the higher your turnover, the more you make in tips. So there is an incentive in that business for tips. In Japan, people, if they sit there, it doesn't matter how long you sit there. It's a little bit more relaxed, I think.
That's
but
true.
You make less, ultimately. Same. Yeah.
That's interesting.
All right, I want to shift this now to where do you find out about All Baito, to shift back to the burgers, because everyone working here is a Baito, right? Let me just, I can shift this over to you for a second here. Everybody who's working in there is a part-time job worker. They're serving the restaurant and everything. So they're making what you made, Hana.
Yeah.
Yeah.
About $10 probably.
About $10 an hour.
Yeah.
And did you get free goods? Like I know at McDonald's, I think you got free food or reduced rate food. Did you get any like free convenience store food?
I only got that like once or twice.
Once or twice?
It's really sad because all this food gets wasted. The ones that pass the expiry date.
Yeah.
But they don't give it to you. We don't get it for free.
So you didn't put it, you know, like try to snake it, you know,
no.
like put it. I don't know. You wouldn't want expired onigiri anyway, maybe.
Yeah,
or
that's
baked
true.
Items.
It's
they just,
hard.
You'd have to throw it away, right?
Yeah.
How did you find out about this convenience store job? Where do you go to learn about jobs? Yeah. And I'm going to tell you after Hana replies, I'm going to tell you about where you find out about like English jobs as well. So let's start with you, because you had a Japanese based job.
Yeah. So the convenience store I worked at, I didn't necessarily see any sign. There's usually a sign like hiring now, oboshitemasu sort of like phrase, you know,
oboshitemasu.
Posted in front of the store to let people know that they're hiring. But I didn't necessarily see that in my convenience store, so I just went in. I literally just went in and asked, are you hiring now? And they were like, oh, Yeah, sure. and so I wrote my name down and I wrote my phone number, and they said they'll contact me back on the interview dates. And so I just waited and they gave me a call, and so I went in, and honestly that was it. So it's not necessarily that if there has to be a sign in order for them to be hired. They are, they just don't have a sign in front. So yeah, I would encourage you to just try and talk to them.
Just walk in and ask. That's what I did that when I was looking for Baito after university. After I finished my university, I came to Japan. I traveled around the world and blew all the money I made waiting the tables. Because I think, you know, you should do that,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
I made $3,000, a little bit over $3,000 that summer, and I blew it all backpacking. And then I came back to the U.S. and I said, okay, now time to look for a job. And that's when I applied for some part-time jobs at like Barnes & Noble and some other places. Like, yeah, I don't know, just something.
Yeah.
And then I said, my friend said, you got to come to Japan. And my first job was teaching English in Japan after college. And that's, I never really left. I just evolved from that.
Wow.
It's really cool. Steven Robson, thank you so much. I'm going to take some questions at the end. If you do super chat me something, I will take the questions right away. But, you know, thank you. But so I get some follow-up questions before I answer on English-speaking jobs. What other resources? So you just walked in, but what are the other options that people have to look for Baito for in Japan?
There are multiple online websites that you can look at. I know I can't think of top of my head, but I can think of one, which is Baitoru. That's one.
Baitoru.jp?
Yeah, .com.
.com? Okay.
Yeah, I think so. They have commercials going on all the time with catchy songs. But anyways, you can just like type in the location of where you want to work, type in Baito, and like a bunch will come out. So that's also an option. If you don't know exactly the store you want to work, but you have an idea of cafe or something like that, and you know the location, you can just type that in and like a bunch will come out. Yeah.
Yeah. Cool. Yeah, there's a lot of online resources that we didn't have 20 years ago. Like, seriously, when I first came to Japan, I remember talking with the other English teachers in the school. They were usually 20-something women, and they were working at the English school as Baito. And I asked them, like, how they found out about this job.
Yeah.
It was the old methods, newspaper,
wow.
Free papers, that they,
magazines,
the magazines
and stuff,
and, stuff, and recruiting conventions. Right, and that's still quite big in Japan, where you go to a recruiting convention in your black suit and your professional attire, and you would go and look for the job and get the paperwork. And you know, I often wondered, after university, Japanese students will often jump right into a career, right? A low-paying job, like $20,000-$30,000 at a company where they're taken care of, which used to be for the rest of their lives, which is not the case anymore. So they would find that out at these job conventions or at their university. So you would be, Sony would recruit you. Sony would go to the best universities. The big companies would go to the best universities. So the best students would be recruited into these companies and be competitive on that level. So Baito was always something that you did before you graduated, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's
how it was, right?
Mm-hmm.
So the people working at the English schools were usually Baito, or that's what they wanted to do with their careers before they got married, or their ambition, their life goal was to get married and have a family. They already knew that, so they didn't have a career-minded path. But I got into this should I give you the story? All right, I'll give you the story. First, I want to say thank you to Simon Osborne again. It's nice to see you again, Simon. And click the like button if you want us to keep on going, because we might take you, if you want to see some more, Hana and I are right outside of Tokyo Station, and I would like to take you over to you see that right on the other side there, outside the window, that's Tokyo Station. So we'd like to take you around here. If we can get the 250 likes, we will continue this live stream a little bit longer, and then talk about jobs at the Emperor's house. Because the Emperor's like lives right over there, right?
Yeah.
So we're gonna walk over to the Emperor's house and knock on his door and ask for a part-time job if we can get the 250 likes. No. Or maybe we could, I don't know. We'll take you in that direction. How about that, if we can get there? 250 or 300 likes. I keep on changing the number. I got into English teaching because a friend of mine, my college roommate, was, he majored in Japanese at Ohio State University. He was kind of a freak. We thought he was, because he, in his room, he had a futon. He slept on the floor. We all had beds and he had this futon. We thought it was a dog pad. All right, but it was pretty cool because he made space.
Okay.
But in his free time, he also read like Japanese version of Penthouse, Japanese version of Playboy, like dirty Japanese magazines. Like he had some sort of Asian thing. I don't know what was wrong with him. I don't know. But he was weird like that. So he ended up going to Japan, of course, in the JET program as a teacher, Chiba. And after I finished backpacking, he recruited me and said, "You gotta try JET, man. They're hiring, and you should totally do it."
Yeah.
So he helped me out with the application a little bit and what they were looking for, and then sent me a recommendation. And then I applied in Washington, D.C., and I got an interview. It's very hard to get the interview. And Washington, D.C. is the most competitive because it's an international place. Then, in the interview, I was so intimidated. I was like, what, 22, 23? Okay. I was so intimidated that... the Japanese interview was, they put a chair in the middle of the room and have a table in front of you.
Yeah.
And four old guys just ask questions and totally try to throw you off. It's a test. It has nothing to do about the interview.
Mm-hmm.
So I think they gave me questions like, why do you want to go to Japan? And I was trying to be funny and one thing led to another. Like, I think I said the correct temperature for sake is 104.3 degrees Fahrenheit or something from a James Bond movie. I don't know. You only live twice. I was quoting things from James Bond because that was my experience, and I ended up not getting the job. So then my backup was to go to an Eikaiwa, and I interviewed with them, and they said, we can send you to Japan in 5 weeks, which is really fast. We'll give you the COE, Certificate of Eligibility, to go to Japan, and you'll be there in 5 weeks if you teach children. And I said, I came here to teach adults. All right. I'm pretty much like a kid anyways.
Yeah.
So I went there and it ended up being one of the most unique experiences of my life and taught me a different side of Japan than it. And I'm glad for it because the people who taught adults didn't stick around. But if you taught kids, you got into more about the everyday life of Japan, how the family works. I love that. So by the time I ended my career as an English teacher, and I did that for like 6 years.
Wow.
Yeah.
Where were you based?
I started in Okazaki in Aichi-ken, which is near Nagoya, a suburb of Nagoya. That's where Tokugawa Ieyasu was born, the last shogun. And then after that experience, for 14 months I worked there, had a longer contract, more than a year. I got a bonus, like a $1,000 bonus. It wasn't a lot. It was a lot back then.
Yeah.
As well as a lot of the money I saved. And at the end of it, I was going to backpack and blow that money too. But then I did such a good job, the head office said, "Hey John, why don't you go to Hiroshima for 3 months? We'll give you another bonus, pay all of your accommodation. You can just save the money and do what you did in Okazaki in Hiroshima." So I went there and I lived in Hiroshima in 1999 for 3 months. And then at the end of it, they said I did a great job. I turned the school around. So I took the bonus money and I blew it in 6 months backpacking around the world. I went around the world, baby.
Whoa.
Yeah. And I didn't go back home to the U.S. for 2 years. And I remember going back home and saying how much smaller my childhood house seemed because I hadn't been back for 2 years and how much I'd grown as a person. I came back a man, right? I don't know. This came just from an English teaching job.
Yeah.
And then the company said, you know, anytime you want to come back, John, just call us and we'll get you a job and you can come back. And I still had my visa. It was valid. So I said, I'd love to come back and do this job again. So I worked for them for another 2-3 years. Every 3 months, I would travel to a new city and live as an English teacher, turning around in English school.
Yeah.
I made friends in every city. That's why I think this Only in Japan job has been pretty, a little bit easier for me because I know the cities organically from having lived there. All the way from down in Hiroshima up to Fukushima, all of this country and some places outside there, but that belt between Fukushima and Tohoku and Hiroshima and Chugoku, which is the region down there, I know very well. So that's helped me with this job. In 2004, I quit the English teaching thing because I got as far as I could go as a foreigner. I was a top foreigner in the company.
Yeah.
So I started my own business making videos in 2005, and I've been making inbound videos for Japan actually since 2003 when I hitchhiked the country. So I've been on YouTube before YouTube.
Wow.
Can I say that? But that's my background here. So I know a lot about moving, a lot about living in Japan, what the things that you need to do to make a life here. But finding a job and a career here all depends on you now. Now, there's so many, back 20 years ago, there weren't that many people interested in coming to Japan. Japan's reputation started to explode after 2012, I'd say. A big push to bring in foreign tourists, and the culture has really gone out everywhere. Now everybody would, a lot of people would like to live and work here. And the best way to do it is, I think, to come to Japan, first of all, and see if you like it. Number two, all right, this is where, okay, I'm gonna bring Hana back
in
here.
Yeah, hi.
All right. I need you to interrupt me, because I keep on talking.
Okay.
No, but in this part, in 30 minutes in, I want to make it more free.
Okay.
I'm going to give you some tips here in a different way on things that evaluate if you are right. So I want to work in Japan. All right, good. Now you have to kind of validate that, I think.
Mm-hmm.
All right, working in Japan is not the paradise. I'm gonna pop some bubbles, okay? The culture of working in Japan is not the same as in the West. No, all right, it's different. And I'm gonna break this down in the next 5-10 minutes. See if we can get the 250 likes as well. See, so if you want this live stream to continue past 35 minutes, it's up to you. You have a say, click that like button. Working in Japan is not easy. It's not easy. It's different. It's so different. The job that you think that you work, when I watch the TV show The Office, it makes me laugh so much because that would never work in Japan. The office setting in Japan is so different.
Yeah.
The culture is never about you.
Yeah.
The you, the me, is you just take it out. It's about the team. First of all, it's about self-sacrifice in the team. That's why one reason why people work so hard, they don't really think about themselves and their time. They're thinking about their company and the team. Once you become a part of that team, your goal is to win. That's why in Japanese baseball, the home run is pretty cool, but a base hit and a run is more respected than a home run, which is about the self. That's why you don't see big hitters, and why Ichiro is a god in Japan is because he was the ultimate team player, right? He always thought about the team first. You have to have that mindset. And it's not easy for me being in the West. And I knew about this team thing, but I didn't really understand it until my second year working in Japan, because my sense of what justice is, about my personal rights and things like this, that's not, I was like beaten down a little bit by that. I mean, can you tell us, Hana, about your experience? I mean, the job of working in Japan is different than in the U.S. and in Canada and other places.
Yeah.
What you think is what, you know, the kindness and hospitality and omotenashi and you being a guest is different when you become a resident and work here. A guest as a tourist and working here are different.
Yeah.
Don't get that wrong.
Mm.
Hana, explain.
Okay, wait. There's one example that came to mind when you mentioned the difference about the team and the individual. And there was one example that when I was working in the convenience store last summer, it really is about the team, and we all have a self-responsibility as part of this convenience store to make the customer feel like they have a good time at the convenience store. And so if obviously a customer buys a lot of products, we are happy because as part of the convenience store, we are making a profit. And so we are happy as workers. But this past winter, I believe, when I was in Canada finishing my last semester in university, I went to a supermarket and I was buying a whole bunch of products of food, you know, for my upcoming week. And I put all of the food on the little conveyor belt that there is in the supermarket. And the lady who was working there looked at all my food that I was buying. And she like rolled her eyes and she was like, "Ugh, you're buying so much." Like disappointed in the amount that I was buying. Because as an individual, she felt like it was troubling her to have to, like, as a cashier, to put in all the products that I was buying. But So that difference is that...
Where was this?
That was in Canada.
In Canada?
Yeah, in the supermarket in Canada. She was thinking of herself and...
The work she had to do.
The work she had to do for herself. Whereas here, like, we would never even think that because as a company, as a whole, we are having a profit. And so we always think about the team and the profit that comes in. I don't know if that made a lot of sense. But
it does make sense, and I want this still is something that I'm wrapping my head around. But I think you have to accept this.
Yeah.
That if you're working in Japan, you're not working for yourself anymore.
Yeah.
If you're working for a company, now I'm a YouTuber. I work for myself basically. I work for YouTube maybe. I don't know, but I have more say because I'm a small business owner. If you are working for a company, you have to understand that you are not really you anymore.
Yeah.
When you are at the office, you have a pin.
Yeah.
You'll see in Tokyo, people will wear pins.
Yeah.
This is their suit of armor. They're working for their brand, which is their clan, which is part of the history of Japan going back millennium.
Yeah.
And you have to kind of, champion that more than yourself.
Yeah.
And then more than even some of the laws that they make in Japan.
Mm.
There was a situation, and we just got here, James Martin writes in, how many hours per week is considered a full-time job, Hana? What would you say?
Per week?
I don't know. I guess it's close
Whoa.
To... My experience is it would be about the same as anything over 40 would be a full-time job. But if you're talking about overtime, that's not really exist too much in Japan. Overtime is just a necessity. It's something that is part of your job. People are paid usually in salary, right?
Mm-hmm.
If you're a salaried worker, a salaryman...
Mm-hmm.
You don't have a wage, so you're not considered, you wouldn't see any overtime. But in a part-time worker, is there a certain amount of hours they have to work?
Not really. It just depends on how much you put in. Like, there's a sheet that you fill out and how much you're available during the week. And so I was only able to work 3 to 5 hours a day. But others work, like, maybe at least... 5 or 8 a day, but that's still considered a part-time job.
So,
right?
Yeah, this is really good. So, if you were to work 40 hours a week at a convenience store, do you get benefits like health insurance?
No.
So, no matter how many hours you worked at your convenience store, you didn't get social insurance paid for by the company.
I think as long as you're a worker, you're not a part of the... You're not like the shacho of the, you know, chain.
Like a manager
like
would
is
a full-time employee.
Right, exactly.
And a clerk is, no matter how many hours you work, you're considered a clerk or like,
part-time.
A contract worker sort of, like itaku.
Yeah.
So Hana doesn't get, I think actually you might get insurance through working with my company. I'm not sure what... I've had to learn the system too because Hana's my first employee.
Mm-hmm.
But I think if you become a full-time employee or a salaried worker, then you get benefits. You get your nenkin, which is your social security, right? Nenkin is your your retirement fund, as well as social insurance like health insurance, all paid for by the company. And then when you go to the doctor, you have to pay just like 10% of it or something.
Mm-hmm.
It's a pretty good system. And even the prices are pretty controlled, so you don't have to pay a lot.
Mm-hmm.
But part-time workers do not get that no matter how many hours they work. So therefore, you could work 100 hours, you still only get the wage. And I don't even think you get overtime, right? I don't know. I think there might be laws, but some of them are not enforced.
Mm-hmm.
And if somebody pushes it, this is the last thing I want to talk about on this. All right, so so what was the most amount of hours you worked in a week?
In a week?
Yeah.
Probably work 4 days a week, 7 hours. 20 hours?
20 hours.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And your health insurance, you had to pay yourself.
Yeah.
Which is probably like 1万 2000 yen.
Something.
Yeah, like health insurance, if you don't have a high wage, it's probably like $120 a month, which is pretty cheap, actually, right? And then if you start making more money, I think I pay maybe $400 or $500 a month now. So it depends on how much money you make.
Mm-hmm.
And then it's capped, so even the super rich don't have to pay too much for their health insurance. The system works fairly well here. Mm-hmm. But yeah, that's interesting. So part-time workers, no matter how many hours you work, you're still considered part-time according to our experience.
Yeah.
Yeah. But so Dragon Darkfire writes in, $120, sign me up. But that means that you're basically in poverty, right? You're working a minimum wage job for a certain amount of time. The lowest I ever paid was 1 year. I made very, very little money, like $10,000 the entire year. I was taking a loss, right? I paid, I think, 5,000 yen for my health insurance a month. So Japan, based on your wage, how much you make, will make concessions on how much you pay into it. So it's not the same for everybody. And I got the same coverage as someone paying more, which is interesting. All right, the last thing I wanted to talk about, I want to continue. Actually, let's continue on this cultural thing.
Yeah.
There was a situation, and it's still ongoing, and it breaks my heart to hear it, where a Western man working for a bank, you can Google this, I'm not going to name him specifically just because the name is not on the tip of my tongue. Tokyo Sam, TKYO Sam, did a live stream on this. It didn't get a lot of views, which is a shame. But he had his take on it, and I'm going to give you kind of my take on it because it's relevant. He was a Westerner working in a bank, and he made a heck of a lot of money for them, all right? And he wanted his paternity leave. And by law, he has the right to take that paternity leave, all right? By law, it's a law. But no one ever takes that maternity leave because the company takes precedence over laws. The individual and your desires are nothing compared to your clan, all right? And this is where it gets into some hairy things. The reason why nobody takes the paternity or even the maternity leave, which is shocking, women will just quit the company and they'll bring in a new fresh face. It's just the culture. It's not, there's no right or wrong. And this is the hardest thing. And this is where the American side of me says that social justice, my rights and things like this. And then there's the side that I've been here for 20 years saying, yeah, if you work for this company, you are the company. You have to follow the company's rules over the rules of the country, almost. It doesn't make it right or wrong. It makes it wrong. But you have to understand, in Japan, you are very much at the will of the company, and bullying is part of it, right? You've seen this in Spirited Away. You remember the Yubaba? She was not a nice person to work for, but that's her company. You have your... In Spirited Away, Chihiro was at the whim of Yubaba, right? I think I hope I'm getting this right.
Yeah,
even in Ghibli, you can see the company, it rules over the rules of what's right and what's wrong, all right? In America, we worry about our personal rights. We should in Japan, don't get me wrong, but that's not the reality here. You have to be a team player. You have to take them for the team. It stinks, right?
Yeah.
And that's why CEOs make a lot less money too, because they still make a lot of money. But in Japan, you just have to think differently. He didn't get his paternity leave, but he took it anyways because he knew he was protected by law. He came, and his bosses at the bank kept on rejecting his appeal for paternity leave, even though he was guaranteed by law. So he took it anyway. And then when he got back, he was bullied and bullied and bullied, and eventually he lost his job because they bullied him and took, and even though he made a lot of money for the company. It's such an awful story. It's so bad that the company is so powerful that they could have influence over the court, right? So they took away all of his witnesses and all the people that talked about his personal, who he is as a person, his character witnesses. They could take that away from him, where he would be the only one testifying for himself. That's how powerful the company is. I think before you get into a Japanese company, you understand you're going to get bullied. You don't understand the language. It depends on each institution. So pick your company wisely. Is that what I want to say? Pick your institution wisely. If it's a conservative old Japanese company, you're probably going to have to adhere to their laws more so than what you think is right. And it does sound scary, right? But the thing is, if you do give yourself to the company, they will take care of you. But once you start to buckle the rules and change the culture, more so the country's laws for employment are ahead of that of many of the companies. But once you buckle the company's culture, then you have a problem because you're changing something that people don't want to change. And I think that you have to just think about that. I think what he's doing is very brave, this man who's taken his big, massive, huge corporation to court. And the attention that they get will probably determine public opinion, because no Japanese has the guts to do what he's doing. So it's just a ton of respect for this guy for doing what he's doing, changing the culture. But will he ultimately win? Probably not, because I remember watching Braveheart and watching those dudes go, ah! Those people got axed real fast. That's the one where the blood hit the camera. Those are those dudes. So he's taking one for a bigger issue. And that's a whole nother issue. And I guess he had 200, 300,000 views on his Facebook appeal. So I don't know, you in the chats and in the comments below can leave information to that. But I'm in between. I can understand both sides. I don't know. What do you have to say about that? Because you've worked on both systems, Hana.
Yeah, it's difficult because I've never worked in a big Japanese corporation organization, so I can only speak from like my convenience story story or what I hear from my friends. But it is true that my friends who do work in big Japanese corporations have had to work overtime without getting paid multiple occasions, and it's just scary how the system within the company is so strong that, as John has said, it can, you know, be more powerful than law, which is kind of controversial.
Well, this is why a lot of Japanese want to work in Western companies.
Yeah.
A lot of
yeah.
Japanese would like to work for, you know, like Apple or Google because
right.
they're treated better and for themselves as individuals than in
yeah.
Japanese companies, right?
Yeah.
And now I hear a lot of Westerners coming and saying, how do I work in Japan? It's like, I don't know, maybe you should ask the Western companies to work at their branch in Tokyo. Because some of my friends at Google, not related to YouTube, they came in by requesting to work in Japan from their head offices in Google. So, I don't know.
Yeah.
Like, do you really? My question is, all right, you want to work in Japan, but do you really want to work for a Japanese company? And if you do, you really need to understand what it takes and what you're giving up to work in them.
Yeah.
This is the side that nobody explains to you. You as a guest, and I'm just going to reiterate this for those who are joining us, you as a guest in Japan, as a tourist, see how beautiful and safe Japanese culture is, but the work culture is different. I myself would not want to be a part of a Japanese corporation. Mm. I'm just telling you honestly that I'm a ruined man. I'm an entrepreneur, I'm a businessman, I would like someone who want to work for myself and find opportunities helping Japanese corporations bridge and do the things that they can't do because their rules are so strict, and me as a small business, I can break those rules because I understand them, I can connect them to something bigger.
Mm.
But to work in their big corporation, I don't think I have that mentality because my value to Japan is being able to bridge my skills to other cultures and other countries right now. I can't do that if I adhere to the rules that are internal in Japanese companies, including NHK. And how many Westerners I worked with at NHK that said, I'm gonna change NHK's culture. I said, yeah, you know what? It doesn't start with one individual. And good luck with that, because that's they have their way, the NHK way. There's the Toyota way. There's the Tokyo Mitsubishi UFJ Bank way. There's, you know, the JR way. Every company has their own way. That's even stronger than the culture, because you're giving your life to the company. This is almost a given if you work for a Japanese company. And if you do want to get a job at the Japanese company, I would, if I were you in your interview, give that, even though maybe it's not your heart, but give that impression that you are ready to give everything to the company, including your time and your rights. And then they in turn will take care of you. And that respect of being a guest changes when your boss starts to dictate the way you should live your life. Because that will happen. I just popped some bubbles, you know, like right now. Like, oh, I want to work in Japan.
Yeah.
I don't know. I think Michaela, another YouTuber, also had a video on the Japanese entertainment business and why she doesn't appear on TV. That went viral. and she spoke from the heart and from personal experience. And Michaela has somebody who has worked within the Japan culture. When I was at the English school, I worked at the headquarters of the school, so I had a desk at that office. Although I was almost never there because I was always away. When I was in that office, which is very rarely, you can see it's a Japanese office. It's a Japanese corporation. They have their rules, and you're respected by how hard you work. And opportunities come to you by how hard you work and how much they beat you and how much you stand up strong and say, I'm still here. And the companies will beat you, and you're still here. And those are the people that get promoted and get more chances. That's how the system works. Yeah. And the old guys that are the bosses, they'll treat you the way that their bosses treated them the generation before. And that's why things move kind of slow in Japan. Because yeah. One company that I worked for, he took me out on an expense account. And I said, in this day and age when Japan's economy is not doing well, why would he just waste money on like hostess clubs and entertainment? And he said he earned it because he worked really hard. He worked his butt off and when he was a low worker. Now he's gotten to become the director of the company and he's got the funds to go out and spend it. So he went out and he used his power the way he wanted to when he got to the top. And that meant that everyone below him worked pretty hard too, the way he did when he was a generation ago, even though the system changed. So the system is probably 30 years behind in Japanese companies, but it's evolving. Just not, it's not what you think it is. Boom! Done!
Boom!
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm. And this, no, sorry, go
no,
ahead.
No.
You go.
No, 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 you go.
You go.
All right, rock, scissors, paper, go. All right, you win,
oh,
go.
Oh, shoot. And also just a comment about like the culture, the workplace culture, is that it's mind-blowing for me. This summer I went to visit my brother in DC and I got to meet his co-workers and his boss as well. And at one point we were all having a little get-together at my brother's place and he just casually mentioned that the person sitting next to him is his boss. And they were just, and it was mind-blowing to me because they were talking so casually and the boss had been invited to his house so casually, and here there's such a like a hierarchy. There's such a hierarchy, and so the boss is the boss and there's a certain way you kind of have to engage with him, and the way you speak in Japanese also sort of changes.
Yeah.
Called the keigo, which is the polite language, polite way of speaking, which you have to talk to, you know, elder people with respect. And so it's such a different workplace, you know, etiquette that, you know, in the US it might be that you can be very casual with your coworkers and your boss, but here it's very divided. You can see the levels, you know, you're the bottom and then there's a way you speak with top person.
Yeah.
And they speak differently with the top person. That's also something to keep in mind.
Yeah, don't,
well.
You don't call your boss by his first name.
No.
I remember going after, there was a break where I went back to the US in 2003 and I was working in a company. My boss was like, yeah, just call me Jack. And I'm like, wow, that's so informal,
yeah,
Jack.
Yeah,
do you understand, like in Japan, this would be not, never be, you show a lot of respect. And this is, all right. This is why Japanese workers also are the most competent in the world. I think American workers are pretty good too. Don't get me wrong. I think workers are, every worker is different, right? But in Japan, in general, people work pretty darn hard and are competent within the skills that they know. Right? I say that if there's anything that requires independent thinking or risk, then they won't do the job because they need to get confirmation from the people above them, because risk is not something, it's all about alleviating risk. So things take a lot longer in Japan when working with Japanese, you'll find that it doesn't. And this all has to do with baito, because you have to understand where your bosses are coming from if you ever want to get anything higher. Risk is something everybody wants to avoid because reputation is more important than money in Japan and probably in anywhere, right? Your reputation is more important than the money because money comes from your reputation. That's how work comes from. So in Japan, people want to alleviate risk, which is also why Japanese companies are losing to Korean companies in technology, yada, yada, yada. But in the workplace, Japanese workers are very competent. They do their job to the letter of the mark. They are on the ball and they work hard and work overtime, and they're so conscientious and perfectionists on doing it. And the way that they're taught, they adhere to that, to the rules. On the flip side, if they have to break the rules or do something and like think outside of the box, which means taking risks, then that change up will make them take a double take. Case in point, sir. Overruled.
Yeah.
If you ever talk to a convenience store clerk at the supermarket clerk and try to make conversation with them, right?
Oh,
like,
yeah.
Itenki desu ne. Or just like try to make conversation while they're working. I would do that in the US. They make light conversation. Boy, your child is so cute or something.
Yeah.
It, like, if you do that with the convenient, at the clerk at the supermarket, they're thrown off of their cycle. Like, they did not train us.
Yeah, it's like error.
Yeah, error alert, malfunction, code 6. Yeah. Customer trying to make conversation. How do I talk without with avoiding any risk and not making him upset?
Right, this is not in manual.
Just no. Agree, polite nodly, say hi, and get him out of the way. I don't want to upset him. So small talk in Japan can be risk. Salesmen are good at it, but everyday clerks don't try to make small talk and expect something, because I remember 20 years ago, there was a cute girl at a Mr. Donuts, and my friend's like, oh, you should talk to her.
Yeah.
And I was like, really? I don't know what to say.
Yeah.
So I was like, yeah, just write down your number and say, I'll give you a call sometime. So I went up to her while she's working there, and I knew like no Japanese, so I said what I said, and I gave her my number, and I said, I want to, you know, like, let's, and she took that like completely wrong, because she was working. Mm. She wasn't herself.
Yeah.
And it didn't work out the way I thought it would work out.
My.
But we learned from that experience. And I ate a lot of donuts that day.
Okay. Okay.
But I remember that did not go the way I wanted it to.
Yeah. Wow.
Just so she did her job.
Right.
And she stuck to it. Or that was her excuse to say no.
Yeah.
It's not exactly clear to me.
No, but one time they're also scared of, like, what if their, you know, manager is watching them.
That's another point.
Yeah, because I have a friend who works at Arubaito in a cafe, and I went to go see her, but she can't really, like, I was laughing on this
side. Is she getting hit on a lot? Hmm? She had a lot of guys say,
no.
That doesn't happen in Japan. Like,
no.
Hey, lady,
really.
Let's go out. I don't, I'm still
really.
Wondering how I met my wife. How did she say yes? But.
Anyway, she works there, and you know, it's my good friend, so I'm kind of laughing and like smiling at her and looking, but she can't really look this way or laugh because her boss is there, and her manager is there, and so it's really this like different persona that you kind of have to put on at the workplace.
Right.
You can't really be informal because it's the workplace, and it's a very common
These are all things I think that you really have to consider, because you might have an advantage being Western and knowing English, but that doesn't mean that you're guaranteed a job.
No.
You also have to have the cultural sensitivity, and the person who gets a job will someone who knows how the system in Japan works. Your job working here should be, how do you fit into the system that they have, not the system that you want to be a part of? How can you be a part of their system? How will you integrate? How will you be an asset to their system? And how will you not make their job harder? How will you take risks away from hiring a Westerner, a foreigner? You, of course, are not born here. You don't know how the system works. So how do you make them feel comfortable with hiring you? This is the mindset that I have when I work with clients, or I try to get a job as a YouTuber looking for permission to film somewhere. I have to convince them. It doesn't matter that we have 1 million subscribers on the main channel. It's how do I convince big corporations to work with me, and I'm not going to be I'm going to be an asset by making this video with them. I have to convince Honda. When I first did the channel, it took me 3 months to get permission from Honda to work with Asimo. Even though I said, look, I'm going to bring in people to your welcome center to see Asimo's performance. This is a win-win. It still took 3 months to alleviate the risk and see, be an asset to them in their eyes. And I was pretty positive through the entire process. And in the end, I didn't get paid by Honda at all.
No.
But I did get access, and I got to kick a soccer ball with Honda, and that was with Asimo, and that was just too cool. That was worth 3 months of pain of meetings.
That's awesome.
You have no idea how hard it is to get permission in Japan to film. It's getting easier because influencers is a word now. But when I came, when I started the channel, to get permission to film was so hard. I worked so hard on this channel. People don't understand. All right, thank you so much. We get to 175 likes. Let's try and push this up to 400 likes. Han and I are going to take you outside a little bit where we're going to end this live stream and show you a little bit of the Emperor's house. Because one day, that's all right. So one day we'd like to meet the Emperor.
Yeah, that would be really cool.
And but we're going to have to learn a new form of Japanese. Do you know that? Can you speak that form of Japanese? Keigo?
Oh, Keigo?
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, I want, how would you tell the boss, I want, so like, I want a coffee. Kohi onegaishimasu, kohi hitotsu onegaishimasu. How would you say that in Keigo?
Eh? That was Keigo, though.
That was Keigo, yeah, onegaishimasu.
Yeah.
Let me think of another. Yeah, itadakimasu deshouka. Like, that's like coffee kudasai, you know, like, to their itadakimasu deshouka.
Yeah.
Like, that's really, really, we got some things. Let's we can get this to 400 likes. I'm gonna treat Hana as well. Do you want a burger or something else, Hana? Lunch is on me.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
That would be awesome.
Yeah, we got some wonderful super chats here. And much appreciated. I don't know, do you want a burger? You want something else? I don't know, if you want to eat healthy.
Vegetarian.
Another burger? Which one?
Vegetarian burger?
Oh yeah, that's right, you're vegan.
Yeah, vegetarian.
She's vegetarian. Okay. All right, we'll go to a vegetarian burger place.
Okay.
I should eat more vegan too. And there's also a Thai restaurant here.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So they might have vegan stuff or vegetarian stuff.
Yeah.
So Hana eats eggs, right?
I do.
Yeah.
I do.
Stays healthy.
And dairy.
Dairy too.
Yeah.
This is a place that I think everybody should come to if you come to Tokyo Station to look around. Outside these doors, you're going to see a wonderful view of the old exterior of Tokyo Station. I've been here before in many live streams, but I think if you want to get an overview of the city, this is a pretty cool place. You don't have to go too high, and I always get freaked out when I step on this. I don't know. Step on glass, I'm always think it's going to burn. But it's such a beautiful overview of Tokyo. And to me, the Marunouchi Station right here is as much of an icon of the city of Tokyo as Tokyo Tower would be. This came before Tokyo Tower. This was built, I believe, 1912. Yeah, and you can see the Shinkansen just coming in right there. Do you see? Coming in at Tokyo Station. You'll get these really awesome views of the trains coming in from the left and the right. That's the International Post Office where I send my Patreon packages. If you want to join the Postcard Club, you get a postmark that says Tokyo on it. I send it from the main post office here with the coolest stamp I can find. So that's where all your postcards are sent, right inside there. It's pretty nice weather today, but you can see the old architecture from the early 20th century combined with the background of Tokyo's 21st century. As a technology, insert hyper futuristic music with a lot of ding 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 ding, you know, like it was a futuristic electronic sounds. The train leaving. Oh yeah, and the Olympic taxis. They actually have those at the Olympic store. You can buy like Matchbox car models of these cars, these taxi cabs. And Toyotas, they're made by Toyota and they started making them about 2 years ago. And now they're so spacious inside. They don't take as much luggage in the trunk actually.
Really?
Yeah, it seems like a lot less, but inside the taxis you can fit a lot more, which is good. And for people with long legs, they'll like that a lot more too. Yeah. Very nice. Yeah, I could admire this view for hours and hours and hours, but I'm getting hungry too. Is there anything that you want to leave people? Also, I'm going to give everyone about 5 minutes of Q&A here. If you do have questions that you want to ask, let us know, because right now we can answer something. Maybe you've been watching, interested about working in Japan, you have something specific, let us know right now.
Hello.
And you can just speak freely. I'm looking at the questions.
Oh, okay. What do I say?
I don't know.
Hello.
What are you going to do in September? What job do you want?
What job do I want?
Yeah, what's your career path?
Your career path?
Only in Japan. No. What do you want to do? What's your career path?
That's
what do you think?
That's a great question. You know, I'm going to say I don't know. And you know, I don't know my career path, but I have a broad idea, is that I want to eventually get into like the movie industry and work on movies that move people. Movies. Sorry. And you know, I'm personally very interested in social justice topics, like, you know, feminism, LGBTQ topics. And so my dream is to come back to Japan after a few years of, you know, developing skills in overseas, is to come back to Japan and try to raise more awareness on those topics, because it's something that isn't greatly represented, especially in media. And, you know, the world is changing, and I think more open-minded people are coming into Japan, and not to say that Japanese people are not open-minded, but I think there could be more progress made in that area. And so I want
to contribute. That's some good stuff.
Yeah.
I think younger people are very, you know exactly what you want to do. That's impressive. For me, like, what kind of a person, I champion one thing: happiness.
Yeah.
Like, if I could file it under happiness, then that's what I champion. That's why, to me, Space Boat makes me happy. Shinkansen makes me happy.
Yeah.
Ekiben makes me happy.
Good.
Yeah, Kanai makes me happy.
Oh,
Hana makes me happy. I'll champion
Hana. Thank you.
I like the post office. I champion the post office things. They make me happy. Post office people are pretty nice here.
Yeah.
Yeah. There's another thing right there that makes me happy.
That's good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Our moderators make me happy. Good job.
Food
makes me happy.
Yeah.
Yeah, the taxi prices here don't make me happy. They're kind of expensive. They did lower it, but they go less for places now.
Yeah.
So I'm just now discussing things in front of me. And I usually will approach things in front of me. Topics that are too big, that I try not to, and controversial in the media, we try not to get wrapped up in it. Because if you piss off 5% of your audience, that's a pretty big percentage.
Yeah.
So it's hard to become an activist, I think, or social justice and things like this.
Mm-hmm.
And I think everybody should have justice, but I don't focus too much on that in here. Just even yesterday when Heisenberg,
mm-hmm.
What's his name from, did you ever watch that Breaking Bad?
Yeah, Walter White.
Yeah. Doesn't Dan look like Walter White?
Yeah.
Go back to our live stream yesterday and check it out. He looks like Walter White.
Yeah.
Even Heisenberg, he talked about like the political issues of food in the United States, and I'm like, oh boy, that's gonna rub people the right way and rub people the wrong way. So I try to avoid divisive issues and try to take things that bring people together, and then from that, I think you can, if you can't bring people together, then I think you're never gonna go forward on any issue.
Yeah.
Right. That's just how I feel. So if you're very abrasive, like right now with Korea is with this boycott of Japan stuff, it's like so abrasive.
Yeah.
If you can't bring people together, I don't think anyone will ever take you seriously or champion your causes. It's just the wrong way about doing things, about anything. So.
Yeah.
They do say ignorance is bliss. So I'm reading some of the comments now. This has to do with Hana's job. A living wage in Tokyo would be gojumayen, 500,000 yen a month. That's a good question. I don't think so. A living wage would be about, the average wage is like, I think for people under the age of 30 is like 250,000 yen a month, which is about $2,300. That's about right?
Yeah.
An initial postgraduate wage is probably between, unbelievably, 180,000 and 250,000 yen a month, I would say. 250,000 being on the generous side, depending on what you're majored in. But a normal salaryman job would probably be about nijuman a month, plus all of the benefits, plus you'd probably get a small bonus at summer and winter time, which kind of balances out. Although the wages are low, the salaries seem low, there are bonuses where you get a big percentage of your income through them in the summer and then in the winter. And the reason for the bonus is taxes. It's a tax thing. So the bonuses are adjusted so that the companies can avoid paying even more taxes by giving the bonuses based on the profits of the company at that time. So you get bigger bonuses if the companies do well, and smaller bonuses if the companies don't do well or no bonus at all. But it has to do with paying less taxes, I believe. I think it has taxes are a big thing in Japan now that it, you know, I have to do them myself for the last 10 years. More than that, my gosh. But it also has to do with teamwork. So if the team does well, you do well. If the team doesn't do well, you don't do well. So fight for the team, which is probably why in Canada, the person at the register rolls their eyes when you when you have too much stuff. And in Japan, they're kind of encouraging you to buy more,
yeah,
because in the end, this will come back to them in the bonuses. Just a totally different philosophy on the way things work. 500,000 yen is, I think if you're like 40 years old and older, that's a decent wage.
Yeah.
A living wage would be about 200,000 yen, and your rent would be maybe 60 to 75,000 yen a month, which is a 1K, which is a one room apartment, and you'd be able to save money off of that. Yeah,
mm-hmm.
So you'd still be able to save money off of that. And then in your 30s, I would say 350,000, and then in your 40s, it's very age-based in Japan.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, in your 40s, 500,000, and then maybe in your 50s, you want to be making at least rokujuman, 600,000 yen a month or so, 650,000 yen, because you want to save. And you're gonna have to pay more for nankin and health insurance and things like this, and your family. I don't think you can support a family on under 500,000 yen a month. But if you're by yourself, 180 to 250,000 is living.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I hope that's helpful. Anything else here? I make less than $15,000 a year. You can live off of that, but you just can't save a lot of money. If you're thinking about a baito as your career choice in Japan and you're not a Japanese citizen, I would say think twice, because the biggest thing about living in Japan is, do you have money to support yourself? All right. No country's gonna bring in somebody that's gonna be a burden on their social systems, right? And Japan already has too much of a burden. As we look at a tourist bus, let's see if we can get the 400 likes, everybody. So if you're watching this, if you like this content, click that like button. Yeah, no one's gonna hire you if you're gonna be a liability for their social services. So you have to prove that you have enough money. One of the things that I did when I was renewing my visa was also show my bank statement that I had like $20,000, $30,000, $40,000 in the bank. So I'd be able to support myself if I lost my job as a freelancer. I was able to extend my visa for a couple of years as a freelancer. So no company sponsored me, so I didn't have a company backing me, but I could extend my visa based on the income. There's things that you can do. I no longer need that. So these are really good questions that you have, everybody. If I lose my job as a responsible YouTuber, YouTubing is not something that you can say as a job. International services, you can get married to someone who's Japanese, or you can get permanent residence called Ajuken, and then they can't take it away from, but that also changes your tax burden, and you have to pay into Nankin system, and you have to pay more if you do become an Ajuken. It changes the death tax too for you. If a family member in another country dies, then you have to pay taxes in Japan on that. So there's other things that you have to consider with that. Credit cards are not accepted there much, correct? That's not true, Cooper. The credit cards are accepted in almost everywhere, with the Olympics has even increased that. 7-Eleven ATMs take foreign credit cards. So 7-Eleven, as well as the post office takes foreign credit cards for cash. So you can always get cash out now in Japan. In 1998, I couldn't. I couldn't get advance on my credit card, so I was broke for the first month, and I was eating samples at supermarkets to survive.
That
was pretty bad.
Oh my God.
I've had to fight. My story is long and hard. Yeah. I'm very happy with what we have. So I highly recommend this view for this. All right, we're gonna go to your vegetarian burger place. Let's see if we can get 35 more likes before we end this live stream. And I'm gonna take you outside of the streets and show you maybe where the emperor lives. His house is nice, but you just can't really see it. This is the Maru building on the Maranuchi side, the fifth floor. I'm sorry, I totally forgot that even though you have a little bit of Hawaiian in you.
Me?
Yeah. And I say that because your mom likes Hawaii, so that, yeah, that gives you aloha spirit. She lived in Hawaii.
Raised, yeah.
You're raised in Hawaii.
She's not Hawaiian, but she was raised in Hawaii until, yeah, she left for college in Boston.
So she's got that aloha spirit in her.
Yeah, definitely.
If you want to know who her mom, she's been in a live stream three times, I think. Yeah. At the Enoshima Spa, look for the Mount Fuji Onsen from 2 years ago, and then just last week in Kochi, she was dancing for us.
In Sado?
Yeah, she was dancing. You could see Hana's mom dancing.
Yeah.
She was boogieing too. I could see that aloha spirit.
Yeah, she was a cheerleader. So in high school.
That explains a lot. She's still a cheerleader now.
Yeah.
Once a cheerleader, always a cheerleader.
Exactly. The spirit, yeah, never dies.
Mahalo nui. Right. Mahalo. So we got that aloha spirit, and I like that. That's one of the reasons Japan, Hawaii is so popular with Japanese. That spirit, that aloha spirit.
Yeah.
I like it too. I like it a lot. Just like this escalator. Going down to the central business district, and I would consider Maranouchi to be part of the Tokyo Central Business District because a lot of people work here. My accountant is here in Maranouchi too. Just a building down the street from here. I used to do my taxes myself, but it started getting really complicated as the tax laws changed. I just couldn't do it myself. Now I have to pay an accountant, or else I would have zero time. Another thing that I'm thankful for Patreon for. Yeah. This year, there's a little exhibition for the Rugby World Cup. That's the biggest rugby ball in the world. This used to be in Yurakucho. They moved it here in the Shinmaru building.
Actually made of rugby material? That's a
freaking rugby ball.
What?
Yeah. It totally is. Check it out. Right there.
Oh my god.
Whoa. This is new.
What?
Hey, Hana, go sit there. How small are you? Oh my word. He's big. And he's holding a rugby. So this is a temporary exhibition. Is he made of chocolate? Don't lick him, don't lick him. All right. I've seen him before on TV. Who is this? Yeah.
191 centimeters.
Almost 2 meters tall. We put him like 6 feet and double digits maybe. This guy's built, man. He could play rugby. Give him the ball and no one can tackle him. Just keep going.
I know. Is
dude.
That even fair?
That's not fair. I think rugby should have a size limit maybe. But this is for the Rugby World Cup. This is like the biggest rugby ball in the world. Can you touch it?
Yeah.
I'm going to touch it. I'm touching it for the live stream. This is all for all of you. Describe the feeling. Oh, this isn't a rugby ball. Yeah, it's made out of plastic. But I think there is a real rugby ball somewhere that just made it really big. That starts next month, by the way. Rugby World Cup. Very cool. It's so hot in the summer. This area is treed, forested. Yeah, and it's a good time to give attention to the forest fires in the Amazon. They are happening, the media is not covering it. Let's give it some mention. You know about the forest fires in Amazon? Yeah, there's apparently the biggest forest fire in history of the world is going on. It's a little bit of attention there. It's a rugby ball.
Oh, that's
Hana, that's your size. She's your size.
That's what? A he.
That's a he? Yeah. I thought that was a woman.
Hanyu Yuzuru, the ice skating champion.
Ah, yeah, I know him.
Yeah,
yeah, he's pretty cool.
Yeah,
he speaks good English, too.
Good.
I thought he was a woman just because of the body. I don't know. He could work out a little bit, maybe. I don't know.
He has to be slim for ice skating.
Well, I don't. He'd be hard to tackle, and if you tackle him, he's all bones.
Oh, yeah, true.
But he's really, really cool. best darn ice skater in the world.
Yeah.
Where's your vegetarian place?
Okay.
Where's the vegetarian place?
Yeah.
They're burgers.
I don't know.
Oh, you just okay.
I know.
All right, I guess I know some places to go for lunch. I got some places here.
Sorry.
I know. We got you covered. Big shout out to David Kimura too. Thank you so much. That's more than Asahi, brother. That is Hana's lunch. Hana's lunch money has been covered by David Kimura. Yeah, I'm seeing in the chat some people giving some shout outs on the live stream chats. What's going on in the Amazon? It's not really pertinent to what I do for Only Japan, but somebody's got to start mentioning it a little bit, little by little. Because the Brazilian government and the governments there are not mentioning it at all. They might be even happy because they could turn that into grazing for more cattle, I guess. I don't know. So this way it takes you towards the Imperial Palace, and I'm going to be doing another live stream here in the next couple of months. There's something I want to show you. It's a place I like to go. It's right in front of you, but I'm not going to elaborate because it's another live stream. I gave like little Easter eggs, I guess. Little Easter eggs in this. Yeah, it's more like 2:30 in Japan right now. We don't have daylight savings time in Japan.
No.
Daylight savings time is just... It's just weird.
That really confuses me.
It's too confusing for me too.
So confusing.
Spring ahead, fall back. It's just dumb. It saves time.
Yeah.
Come on, people. It's supposed to save electricity in the 19th century.
Right.
Yeah. There's a show called Veep with the Seinfeld lady, Lufus Dreyfus.
Okay.
And they had some thing where he was trying to rid daylight savings times, but I think it was like a joke. But I'm all for that. But we're 14 hours ahead of New York in the winter and then 13 hours in the summer. So I believe we're 13 hours ahead. This is where the emperor lives, and this is the gate. And this is where the moat also starts here. And last year, 2 years ago, wow, time flies. Some British tourist jumped in there because he was too hot. And he said he lost his wallet and the police arrested him. It didn't end well for him. He made all the TV networks too. So if you want to get on TV, just don't do it though.
Wow.
Just don't do it.
I
don't think it was worth it either. This hotel is all new. This is all stuff just in the last year and a half. This whole area has changed quite a bit. But the Emperor's house is straight that way. I'm deciding whether or not we should go there because it's just gotten so hot. Yeah. This is Route 1 as well. This is the route that takes you to Kyoto and Osaka if you go straight on it, Route 1. Which is Ichigo-sem. Route 1 is the old Tokaido, which if you see those postcards by who did those, the woodblock prints, Utamaru. Gosh, my brain is broken.
I'm not sure.
He did the 52 stations of the Tokaido. This is the Tokaido. The start of it is right here at Nihonbashi, which is just like 500 meters away. I get a ton of little antidotes about this city. That could be another live stream. All right, everybody, thanks so much. Really appreciate you taking the time to watch and listen about working in Japan. Hope this gave great insight. We'll be taking a look at the comments for the next day or two. So if you have any questions, leave them in the comments below. Definitely hit the like button if you want to see more Hana. If we don't get the 500 likes, Hana will never be on the show again. This is your last live stream ever because you don't get the 500 likes.
Oh.
People have proven that they don't. I'm totally kidding.
Okay.
I'm totally kidding.
Okay. I'll probably pop up here and there.
Yeah. Actually, before you go, and her last day is September 12th,
yeah.
We need you to sing to us to give us hope.
What?
Yeah, you did last year.
Yeah, for sure.
You did a live stream on New Year.
Yeah.
Give us hope.
Definitely, hope.
And Hana's channel is in the description. So if you want to go check it out, I highly recommend you to subscribe. She doesn't even have 1,000 subscribers yet. And her she has music videos in there
that are so good and well edited. Oh, you totally have to go in and check out if you want to feel inspired. Listen to Hana's bilingual music. It's in Japanese, right?
Mostly, yeah. There's one song in English.
Yeah.
And another song-ish instrumental song in English. So there are two.
Yeah.
Two in English, but
yeah. So go there and subscribe, because we want to encourage her to send a message of positivity.
Yeah.
Which by the way, before we end, when is your next update? I'm a fan.
Update.
I'm waiting.
Thanks. Hopefully before I leave, which on the 12th. So what day is today? Today is 28th.
It's not a lot of time. Have you written the song?
Yes, and I'm editing it.
Wow. Okay. Cool.
So yeah, it's just a lot because there's some words that I'm putting it in this time.
You have to feel it here.
Yeah, it's really so dear to my soul, and I don't want to rush it. I want to really give it the time. So every word is coming from deep there.
Yeah,
inside.
Not even 600 subscribers, right? David, thank you. We just upgraded the burger and added toppings. The veggie burger. So again, once again, for those watching us, Tokyo Station, the Emperor's Palace. He lives in here. So we're not that far away. And if you want to run around, it's 5 kilometers, 5K to run around. I used to do that, yeah.
It's a good course.
It's a very good course. It's a little bit of a hill in there, or you can go the other way, it's downhill.
Wow.
I don't know how that works. Keep going downhill. So there you go. Thanks, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Have a day. Good
Thank
day, good night.
Good night.
From the All Bite people.
Arbeit people?
Arbeito.
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 Yes.
Arbeit.
Arbeit.
From Germany.
From Germany.
Bye, everybody.